could fit a CD in your mouth.
CD's nuts. I don't think I could.
Well,
I could. I reckon I could get a floppy disk in my mouth.
Do you have a floppy disk here?
I mean, not since 1997, but.
Well, I was alive in 1997, which is a win. I know you've got a drawer full of CD-ROMs.
Yeah.
I would pay you $5 if you could get the wider radius of it in your gob.
No, I'm good. Thanks.
I've got to, actually.
I'm not that broke at this point.
I'm going to wager it. I have $20.
I'll take the credit card. I'll take the photo of your girlfriend.
I'll wager $20 if you can put a CD in your mouth.
I think this is a bad choice because the worst possible outcome of this is that somehow I get it in there, but I can't get it back out.
I just push it in.
Yeah. So, look, I don't need like a Liverpool smile.
Chelsea smile.
Well, I'm sure all sorts of English towns give you the same smile. A Glasgow smile.
Do they?
I don't know.
I think it's a Chelsea smile.
Possibly.
I don't know.
Chelsea grin.
Well, who cares?
Chelsea dagger.
At the end of the day, let the record show, Max turned down $20 to do something sick for the podcast. Potential viral moment out the window.
Potential viral moment as my golden staph infection that I have in my mouth when I go to hospital gets in.
It's a small price to pay for fame and success, isn't it? Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks.
It doesn't usually start with weird jackass-style quizzes and challenges.
Anyway, welcome to the music podcast.
Yeah, wow, we've really taken it off track.
Well, we
early.
Mentioned CDs and guitars, so that's a good start. But we like to start the show the same way every time. And that is something new.
If listeners haven't listened to our interview with Tiffy that came out on Friday, first time,
interview.
And I think only time that everyone's ever asked us our question back, which is, what have you been spinning?
And
playlist.
You could tell we were just absolutely flustered. I don't listen to music.
There were all these straws and all I could do was clutch at them because I was in all sorts.
I was naming bands that I hadn't listened to ever. I think I said Suicide Boys. I know two songs.
I think
songs.
You did say Suicide Boys. Yeah. Which is pretty deep cut, like pretty random to throw out there.
I was just trying to be cool for Tiffy, you know?
Yeah, you pulled it off. You made it look good.
I'll tell you what an interview. Shout out Tiffy. She researched us. She listened to us beforehand. She asked for the questions, even though she didn't read them. And it was an hour-long chat.
Yeah, we got properly good content out of that. If you haven't gone back and had a listen.
Arguably
really
one
good.
Of our
I'd say top three interviews.
Definitely.
Yeah.
What's your other two?
Oh, I haven't thought about that. It's like Tiffy all over again. Fuck.
Oh, shit on the spot. I don't like being on the spot. I'm the interviewer. Know your role. Something new, Max.
Something new, Sam. I've been listening to all sorts of stuff at the moment.
Yep. You look a bit all over the shop.
A bit all over the shop. So off a pretty good recommendation from my lovely girlfriend, I've been listening to a new artist, I think out of the UK maybe, called Olivia Dean. I'm going to fact check myself live on the show. And Olivia Dean is dropping some real kind of
pull it up,
soul, soul R&B. She is English. Thank you.
You just thanked yourself.
Yeah. Always thank yourself when you're right. Thank that brain for keeping you in the way. She's soul R&B, real smooth kind of sound. Like a beautiful brass section that comes in to like accompany some piano. She's got such a really good voice. It's very smooth. Very kind of like Ray, you know Ray, R-A-Y-E.
No.
Okay, cool. Sweet. Don't worry about that.
Music podcast.
Yep.
Don't know.
Don't worry. It's all good. but yeah, that's I've been listening to a bit of that. So Dive by Olivia Dean. Hot recommendation.
I like it. Are you going to go through your list or are we going
to
go?
How would you like to do this, Sam?
I don't know. Maybe we go one for one.
Go one for
Keep
one.
It a bit fresh.
Yeah, that's fine.
You know? It's like a good group presentation. You don't want people to get sick of one person's voice.
So fresh. Hits of 2001, mate. Let's go.
Hits of spring 2024.
Hits of spring 2004 turned into summer real fucking quick in Brisbane this week.
Didn't it? Niche content.
Weather anyway. Chat from the past.
Yes. Well, I've been getting real into Gleamer.
Gleamer?
Gleamer. They're a band from America. Let me just check my stats while I'm here.
Sorry, I'll pull that up for you.
I'm pretty sure they're from... Oh, fuck. They're not even big enough for a Wikipedia page.
No, I'll find them. You
they're
keep
from
chatting.
Colorado. Fort Collins, Colorado.
Fort Collins.
Great snow up there. I don't know why I sound like a Mountie.
Also Canadian, yeah.
Yeah. They're moody, like post-punk guitar-driven, like rock.
Yep.
Sort of like punky elements into it. And who knew I'd be so into gloomy music?
Yeah, I mean, actually, I vaguely remember, did you bring Gleamer to the show a couple of weeks ago in your segment about like grunge, hardcore, shoegaze kind of stuff?
Yeah, I'd put it somewhere like punky, wall of noise, like shoegaze.
Right, and any reco songs?
Yes. Come Down is a great song I'm loving at the moment. Down Through, mm-hmm. I think, is the other one.
Mm-hmm.
I just go through their whole album. I think Down Through is the name of one of their albums.
Yep.
That's their latest album. And then Anymore is their album in 2017 that I listen to a lot. But rainy day music, relaxation music, put some Gleamer on. And shout out Joel from Peace Ritual. He inadvertently showed me that way back in the day.
There you go. All right, sick. Shout out Joel. Look, I'll keep it in the same vein then for a little while. We're sticking in America. I'm going with Zach Bryan and his new album. Zach Bryan, I think, in terms of like country music, right up your alley. Because like that man, I mean, aside from having an incredible voice, every syllable, every lyric sounds like the saddest thing you've ever heard.
That could be right up my alley.
Yeah. And it's beautiful music. Like it's country without being like fucking...
She thinks my truck was sexy. Yeah.
It's not that kind of country music, but it has like that kind of twang and it has that like storytelling structure that country does really well. But it's just kind of this sad guitar-driven music. Sometimes it is upbeat, but in a way that's like you can tell like this is the happy bit of the sad bit. You know what I mean? Where like you got to have the happy bits to have the sad bits. Mm. So American Nights. So the album I think is called The Great American Bar Scene. I'm going to double check myself later.
I don't know.
But the song that I'm specifically talking about is American Nights.
Oh, I got rid of that before you had the chance.
That's right. I'm lucky I keep it on my other notes. my the ones that you can't delete. Yeah. So, I mean, it is like very reflective and it's very sad, which will come up in Vinyl Club this week. But I think it's also very like almost like pub rock. Like I could see a bit of Cold Chisel in there or something
Cold
like that.
Cold Chisel?
Yeah.
Bit of Jimmy and Ian.
Yeah, exactly.
And the other two.
Yeah. but yeah, I think I genuinely recommend you should have a listen because I think you'd enjoy.
Yeehaw.
Yeah.
Really turns around. My next one, I haven't really been getting into new songs per se. My release radar was fairly dry on Spotify last week. And you know how it just recycles songs that have been out for 2 or 3 weeks and it really grinds my gears.
Oh, tell me.
I've been getting really, really into Justice for the Damned.
Okay.
So I'd say they're like deathcore, maybe. Think like Die Hard is Murder.
Mm. Virtues.
Virtues, yeah, out of Sydney.
Yep.
Friends of the show, really. Mm. But it sounds really niche, but they recently played a gig in Sydney at the Lansdowne, I think.
I love the Lansdowne. One of the great venues. One of the great Australian venues.
Love it.
Yeah.
And the set was recorded, like one of those high quality sets chucked on YouTube. And I've just been listening to that all the time at work. And they've got some new songs in there that I'll play you a bit of a snippet of later.
Yep.
But when they drop this album, I reckon are going to be the next big thing.
Right.
So you've got sort of Void of Vision creeping up. We talked about it on socials the other day. Void of Vision creeping up. Alpha Wolf have taken off. But I think Justice is on the verge of popping off.
The verge of Vision.
The verge of Vision. Yeah, well, they're very different bands, but I feel like, I think Die Hard is Murder, like huge in Europe.
Mm.
I think Justice could be that big.
Like too. Gyroscope.
Like Gyroscope. Airborne. They come back, or Chase Atlantic too, actually.
Yeah, fair. True show.
Did you know? Sometimes. I looked them up. Chase Atlantic, straight out of Cairns. Yep. Most Australians don't really know who they are. 16 million monthly listeners.
Mm.
They're the 499th most listened to artist in the world.
Really?
Yeah.
It's quite impressive.
That is quite. And if you sitting at home, and sitting there going, oh, 500, that's not very impressive. Think about how many artists there are, how many artists you've got saved in your library.
Yeah.
You've probably got minimum 150.
I probably like minimum 10,000, but yeah, sure.
10,000 artists, you reckon?
Yeah. Not every song of theirs saved.
Oh, no. Yeah. So I've probably got like 2,000 saved songs.
Yeah.
And that's minimum. Let's say I think I'm on the money. Like maybe 500 artists, let's say, generously. But within that, there you go.
I'm just trying to see if there's a quick way to do this on Apple Music. There is not, but no, I will.
It's because it's Apple Music.
I think that I would hazard a guess to say many.
But it's the more you know, hey?
Yeah.
Australian bands in the top 500 most listened to artists in the world, and most Australians don't know who they are.
Well, don't forget that an Australian band has the second highest selling album of all time.
AC/DC
Back in Black. So
rock on, brother.
Yeah. If you want to listen to a chat with Chase Atlantic, we have one
in
the feed.
It's genuinely like the numbers on that.
It's nearly 5 years old now.
It's nearly 5 years old, but it's still our number one listen.
Oh, by such an unbelievable daylight.
It was actually.
You could probably do 5 or 6 times the rest of every other, like you could combined every other pod that we've done, times it by 6, and I reckon you've still got a good.
Yeah. The numbers on that keep our podcast alive.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they really help our average.
A couple others from me. Mall Rat
Is
back. She has dropped Ray of Light.
Where'd she get?
She was in LA for a bit, making some music.
Just touring,
hanging out.
Holidaying.
Just doing LA things, you know how it is.
Being a celeb.
This one is more on the dance pop kind of end of Mall Rat's release. Like Mall Rat has kind of gone from like hip hop to straight up pop. She did some like weird like rock stuff, which was great for a little while. She's back in this dance pop. Like, I think there's not a space that Mallrat doesn't want to just like tackle at some point. Like, she's like, I like that kind of music. I'm going to make that kind of music.
That seems like a lot of artists are doing that though.
Yeah.
Which is a huge vibe.
Yeah, 100%.
Post Malone.
So this is much more something along the lines of her collabs with like Golden Vessel or like the Knox in that area. It's in, you know, like for a Brat summer, it's kind of really in that canon. You know what I mean? Like it's pretty fun. It's pretty danceable. Would recommend.
Okay.
Yeah.
Love it. I'll throw one in. More so just to keep on your radar if you're into the odd world punk sort of scene.
Yeah.
Ocean Grove dropped a new single called Raindrop.
Yeah.
So they've, you know, it wasn't quite for me, but it's a hint of a new album.
Ooh.
Called, I don't know what it's called.
I think the album might be called Odd World.
I think it is called Odd World. But they're bringing back the original lineup from Rhapsody Tapes. So, minus a couple of guitarists, but. Running Touch, back in, and they're bringing back their heavy vocalist, their rah-rah, that vocalist.
Shit.
So if you're a fan of Rhapsody Tapes and not really a fan of the direction they went after that, keep your eyes peeled, mate. Keep your ears to the ground, your eyes peeled. That's
a smart move.
Yeah, anyway, if you don't know who Ocean Grove are, listen to the Rhapsody Tapes.
Or listen to the Vinyl Club that we talked about 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, exactly. Listen to that. I feel like a lot of people tuned into that, but
we had a surprising number on it.
Yeah.
I've got a couple more quick ones. We got at least one or two more.
You've got two more, so you just rattle them off.
All right, I'll rattle through them. Frank and Louis, Sunshine Coast Brothers. This is their first ever song. They've been busking for ages, apparently, and this is their first like proper song that they've dropped. Real like Jungle Giants sound, like but early Jungle Giants, like bright, punchy
nipple guitars.
Yep, exactly like that. Perfect like song for summer. Like they got in right at the right time.
It is coming.
Yep, Bloody Oath. It's called Fat Man. I don't know if I said that up top. Fat Man by Frank and Louis.
Yep.
And then the last one I've got is friends of the show, Egoism.
Oh, love Egoism.
Dropped Getting Older, and it's. To me, it's a bit like sort of stripped back 1975 kind of sound, but then throughout the bridge, like that classic Egoism guitar line, like the layered like so melody good. Counter melody, like exactly what you want from Egoism. It felt like home.
Mm.
Beautiful stuff.
Love it. And just while we're there, you spoke of Fat Man. Rest in peace, Fat Man Scoop.
Oh, pull one out for Fallen Brother.
I actually
on
thought
stage too, which I feel is a bit.
Yeah, he collapsed on stage.
Yeah.
Not gonna lie, I thought it was Fatboy Slim.
I'd be so sad if it was Fatboy Slim.
So I was like, oh no, Praise You and like Rockefeller Skank, no. They're like, no, it's Fat Man Scoop. I was like, oh, I just know he's like call out.
It's about you got a $20 bill? Put your hands up.
Fat Man Scoop. I don't know. But other news. So rest in peace to a legend, and there's a reunion coming. Everyone's spoken about it. If you haven't seen that there's an Oasis reunion coming, get out from under the rock.
I literally don't think there's anyone on earth who doesn't know. Like, mum and dad messaged me about this.
Oh, Max, it looks like Oasis are coming back.
Like, legit, every single person that there is has heard about this, I think.
Mm.
And I mean, I'm super stoked. I'm hyped.
Are you going to go Manchester?
I was genuinely considering trying to buy tickets, realized that they have dynamic ticket pricing on them. Some of them will be insanely expensive.
Mm.
They've announced that if the tour goes well and they continue, they're going to go beyond Europe. Let's not count those chickens before
they
hatch.
Well, to be fair, there's a lot of commentary that they won't even make it past the first show.
Yes.
So you'd want to make sure you're at the first show.
I reckon they should have had like cheaper tickets for the end of the tour.
Yeah.
just in case.
Don't waste your money yet. And then it'll be like an inflation price. So you pay for it in a bracket window. You pay $100. And if the tour continues, you might end up paying $500. But if they cancel it, you've only spent $100.
I think, I'm just looking at this. I think that Australia hasn't had a tour from Oasis since 2005, which is pretty solid considering they broke up in 2009.
Yep.
But they've only had three tours from Oasis, 1998, 2001, and 2005. So, yeah.
What's your favorite Oasis song?
Ooh, Champagne Supernova, obviously, probably. Cigarettes and Alcohol, maybe.
Okay.
It'd be something off of either Definitely Maybe or What's the Story, Morning Glory.
Yeah.
But yeah, one of those two. But everyone fucking knows about that. Everyone knows about Oasis.
Yeah, everyone knows.
No one, if it's become to the point that Wonderwall itself, quite a meme.
It is. Oh, I don't have any favorite songs by Oasis. Thanks for asking. You've got some.
That was a real Max Higgins movie there. I like that.
It was. I just thought I'd get one back while I could. So, like you said, everyone's done Oasis to death.
Yeah.
But you've done a bit of digging because there's a fair few of our listeners who weren't born in the 90s. And, you know, it's not that big a deal anymore.
No.
Before you go, oh my God, it's not that big a deal. They're 24.
Yeah.
So let's just
come. We probably have some listeners that weren't even born in the 2000s.
Do you think we've got 14-year-olds listening to our show?
Someone born in 2010, yeah, 14. It's not out of the question.
If we had 14-year-olds listening to our show, I'd be like,
If you're 14 and you're listening to our show, go to bed. Go to bed.
Go to bed.
I don't care what time you listen to this. Go to bed.
First and foremost, we appreciate that you're listening to us.
Yes. Keep the downs going.
But also, like, how did you find us?
Yeah.
Our demographic does not reflect your age group. I don't even know what...
It was your video trying
what
to
is
say
it
Feminine
called?
Omenon last week.
Yeah, Feminine Omenon. Look at that.
Now the first go. Oh, pretty impressive.
That's BDE.
That's...
Feminine, no.
Oh, you should have retire when you're on top, mate.
Anyway, what were you talking about?
Yeah, so for people who... So I thought I'd list off a few other Britpop songs, you know, from that same era when Oasis was like top of the world. For anyone who was conscious in the 90s / knows anything about Britpop, these are not deep cuts. These are songs that everyone's going to know. But just for the younger folk who maybe weren't there...
Have heard Wonderwall on TikTok once.
Yeah, have bounced off, have gone... All right, I now know about Oasis, but what's the rest of this?
Yep.
Couple of songs we're on.
So if you like Oasis's top songs, here's a bit of a deep dive.
Here's the shallowest dive you can do that's not above water.
You're jumping off a 10-meter platform into an inflatable pool.
Exactly. Mm. So I mean, Oasis, obviously they're rivals, if you will.
Mm.
The band that the anti Oasis, the No Oasis, which Woo-hoo. Is actually one of their cover bands,
yeah,
was Blur. I like to do a little reference there. That was nice, thanks, Sam. Woohoo.
Yeah,
no. But we're not talking about song two because that's one that everyone knows. It's overdone.
If you don't know, yeah, if you know Wonderwall and you don't know song two, you need to have a look at your music listening.
So I wanted to throw in Park Life. Which is such a tune.
Sounds like a festival.
It used to be a festival, Park Life.
Oh.
But it's the perfect combination of like just some old geezer, some British geezer, like talking about his day, feeling like, fucking, I get up in the morning, I'm woken up by the dust man.
Like, oh, I feel like I've heard that.
And then Damon Albarn is going, Park Life.
Yeah, well, I've definitely heard that.
Yeah, tune. And I think it's doing a bit of the rounds on TikTok now that Oasis is back. But... Just it is a genuinely banging song. So
yep.
if you need a way in for Blur that's not song two.
Park Life by Woohoo.
Common People.
Yep.
Another fucking awesome song. These are all pretty good. I'm gonna say it every time. But
this list I created, fuck, it's awesome.
my music taste? Fuck.
Did you know I have a music podcast? Hi, I'm Max. Usually I get them the other way around. I just got a bit excited.
Common People by Pulp.
Yeah.
You know, one of those songs that starts out pretty standard, and just turns into like an explosion of what the fuck by the end.
Yeah.
But what I'm going to shout out is there's a cover is a strong word. There's a rendition that Pulp did with William Shatner, where he kind of like William Shatner speaks all the lyrics of Common People. And it's pretty fucking good.
That's so niche.
It's so good though. To the like, even like the band are in on it. Like they're playing in the background.
Yeah, right.
And it's him just like sort of talking the lyrics. So yeah, get around that. Brimful of Asher by Corner Shop. Brimful of Asher on the 45.
Oh, that's wrong. Yeah. Yep.
Norman Cook / Fatboy Slim, not dead. Did a remix of that one. Highly recommend. That if you're going to go in on Brimful of Asher, that's the one you go to because it is so much more fun and so much more like upbeat and dancey. Like the original song's great, don't get me wrong, but that remix is it's
what
stuff.
Everyone knows.
Yeah, it's the one you want.
Side note: are the Verve British?
They are. They do count as Britpop.
So you'd throw in Bittersweet Symphony.
I mean, you would, but I feel like it's again, everyone knows it. If you know Wonderwall and Song 2, you know Bittersweet Symphony.
Yeah, well, I'd say you know Bittersweet Symphony before Song 2.
Probably.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I thought I'd leave that.
They weren't paid for it. Oh.
Have we talked about that on this show before?
Too many times.
All right.
Fuck then, you, Keith.
A couple of older ones in the Britpop movement. Fool's Gold by Stone Roses.
Great movie.
Yes, with Matthew McConaughey. Hey, ho, hey. And
Kate Hudson.
I was going to say Kate Winslet. I knew it was a Kate.
And Kevin Hart.
Really?
And a bunch of Australian actors.
Was it filmed here?
Yes.
Yeah. Interesting.
In Cairns, I believe.
Oh, with Chase Atlantic.
Yeah. Chase Atlantic did the soundtrack.
Chase Pacific at that point.
Oh, he's like, he gave the first laugh.
Anyway, Fool's Gold by Stone Roses.
Yep.
It's a bit more of that like almost dance kind of thing that was going on early 90s. Almost a bit ravey. And I think... anyone who's played, I might be going off track here. Anyone who's played Matt Hoffman Pro BMX?
Oh my god, what a game!
It was the lead single on that game.
What a game!
Yeah, yeah.
Oh,
so you probably know that song.
I got it in a cereal box.
I think. Yeah, me too.
Yeah, it's so good.
in a Nutri-Grain, I believe.
Yep, the warehouse was the best level.
And finally, probably the most obscure of the ones that I've got on this list, Loaded by Primal Scream, was also a bit dancey, a bit like somewhere that sits between like Park Life, Odd and Strange and Talky and like a 90s dance rave song. I don't really know how to describe it apart from those two things and like something that's meeting in the middle. So, you know, if that's the obscure one to throw on the playlist, go for it. Have a listen to Loaded by Primal Scream.
I like it. Well, I just looked up the Matt Hoffman's Pro BMX soundtrack.
Yep.
What a game, first of all.
Huge.
So good. Very pixelated nowadays.
Oh, yeah.
It's just...
It needs a remaster.
It's literally just pixels. But, like you said, Stone Roses, Fool's Gold, Hip Hop by Static X.
Ooh, yep.
B.O.B., Outkast.
Ooh.
I don't know some of these. Everything Turns Grey, Agent Orange.
I mean, very like old school, like hardcore punk from the 90s.
Yeah. Wouldn't It Be Nice, Pennywise.
Oh, yep.
Racer X, 10-foot pole. Don't know what that is. 52 Girls by the B-52s.
Oh, that's a deep cut that I'm struggling to remember, but from memory, it's bringing back
unavailable
something.
In soundtrack menu, but credited. Hmm. Grandma got run over by a reindeer, Dr. Elmo. Shout out Matt Hoffman.
Because I think there was a Christmas level.
I didn't get to that. I wasn't very good.
Oh, right. I think because the first level is the construction site.
Yes.
Yeah.
And you used to have to like grind on all the...
cranes maybe?
Yeah. Mm. I don't know. I was literally about 5.
We're going back.
Do you have a PlayStation 1?
I've got a PlayStation 2.
Is it on PlayStation 2?
I had it on PC.
Yeah, same.
Yeah. Yeah.
PC. I'm a PC gamer.
It's the bloody PC place, isn't it?
Holy shit. It's on PS2.
Is it really?
BRB. You keep talking. I'm just going to go shopping. That, and then I think I might also buy Digimon Royal Rumble Arena.
Royal Rumble Arena. Okay, cool. Well, fair enough.
Niche. Oh, $26. Fuck yeah.
Where are you buying this from?
eBay.
Fuck.
Although then you have to figure out where it's from, like what country it's from.
I mean, oh yeah, because they were all region locked, weren't they?
Yeah. Oh, located in Forbes, New South Wales.
Mate, you are set here.
Anyway, we're going to talk about something else now.
Yes. I very quickly want to just touch on one thing, which was that Brisbane, you've waited long enough.
It's here.
The people have asked and the organisation has listened. Boiler Room, it's coming to Brisbane. I'm really keen to just go be entirely the odd person out in a room full of people who are munted off their faces.
Oh, how do you apply to be the guy at the back of the DJ?
Oh, be the DJ.
No, there's always like... There's
yeah,
like row.
Just behind? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because yeah, yeah. The Chase and Status one, there are these kids and everyone's like, oh, fucking Eshays. Like, what are they doing? But they dead set know every single word.
I feel like you got to know every single word. You got to have the vibe. Like, you can't be like fucking around.
No, and yeah. You got to be chomping your bottom lip.
Oh, 100%. But, so... No, you're ready.
No, no.
So they haven't announced any names for the Brisbane Boiler Room yet. The Melbourne ones, we've got Too Lovely, Crybaby, Fora, like some decent names. Sydney, we're looking at Anna Leneau, Nina Las Vegas, Fuckhead, a few other in there. Skin on Skin, a few other like... pretty solid names, but nothing yet for Brisbane, which it's coming up on the 16th of November, right between Melbourne and Sydney. Maybe there'll be a blend of some of those artists. Maybe it'll be some homegrown Brisbaneites. Who knows?
Love to see a preset Boiler Room.
I mean, I don't think we're going to get presets from Brizzy, but you know, let's never say never.
Just putting them in there anyway.
Yeah. And who knows whether are they bringing some Gold Coast sets? Who
Will
knows?
Sparks.
Yeah. Timothy Trumpet from
Bombs
Brisbane.
Away.
Oh, now we're talking. If you've headlined the Star Casino at any point between 2006 and now, you're on.
Let us know. So where is it in Brisbane? Do we?
It's at the RNA Showgrounds.
Oh, in the tent.
In one of the, you know, like the where the Woolies Pavilion is during the Echo.
Oh, it's in there.
Yeah, yeah.
Yuck.
Yeah, how good would it be like though? Like you're just in there, just like raving off your face. You're like, man. Usually I see like a man made out of apples. I mean, here.
It would be so hot.
Yeah. Oh.
You would be sweating bullets.
Especially the 16th of November. Like, mate.
And the aircon's not going to...
It'd almost be like some kind of boiler room.
Fujitsu does not have the capacity.
It's not Australia's favourite air at this point, is it?
I don't think you got that capacity. Yeah.
So...
Oh, yeah, you're right. It's a boiler room.
Yeah, that's
true.
It's
like a sauna.
Mm, it's crazy how that works, isn't it?
Isn't it?
So, yeah, I'm pretty keen.
Yep.
Let's see how we go. Let's see what we get.
Watch this space, if you will.
Yeah.
All right. Well, it's time for the suitcase.
Mate.
Everyone's favorite segment.
Get into it.
Except, you know, well, it's mainly mine. But bands who never topped their first album.
Sorry. Bands who never topped. Bottom only bands.
Well, bands who never, yeah. Nirvana's not on the top. They topped.
Sorry.
Bands who never topped their first album.
Yes.
So we said on socials the other week, well, I had a theory that for the most part, band's second albums are their best. They never top them. But we're going to take it back a step. Bands who never topped their first album. So we've got a couple here. I'm happy to go first.
Yeah, you want to kick us off.
I'll kick us off.
You've hidden your... So a bit of peek behind the curtain, a bit of inside baseball on how 78 Amped works. We have a shared run sheet. And yes. We each also keep separate notes. And... usually for like stuff like this, we'll just throw in the ones that we're picking to make sure that we don't clash and we don't have like the same one. Sam has deliberately kept his hidden and keeps saying, I've got some controversial takes. So I'm keen to see and hear some absolute smut out of your mouth, Sam.
So bands who never topped their first album.
Yep.
The Wombats, A Guide to Love, Loss, and Desperation.
Are you trying to hurt me? Is this a targeted attack? Wow.
So I've said,
nah, it's fine. I'll just fucking take that knife out of my back.
So I said they've got great tunes throughout their discography.
Yep.
But as an album, nothing's had the same impact. They when they dropped that, Kill the Director, Let's Just Dance to Joy Division, mm-hmm, moving mm-hmm. to New York,
mm-hmm.
all over British TV.
Mm-hmm.
It was absolutely everywhere. It mm-hmm. came over the, you know, or it skip down a hemisphere. They were absolutely everywhere. Since then, I just don't think they've topped it.
Okay.
How can I?
I'm going to agree with you conditionally.
Yep.
I agree that no album has been better than their first one. But I would say at least two albums have been equally as good.
Which ones would they be?
This Modern Glitch.
Yep.
And Beautiful People Ruin Your Life.
I'd agree on This Modern Glitch.
Okay. We could, you know what? That's compromise.
That's a compromise.
That's compromise.
At the end of the day, that's friendship.
After being just kicked right in the dick to start the segment, we've come to a nice little conclusion.
It was just Max, spread your legs, bang. So that's the first one.
Do you want me to go or should you, while you're here?
No,
while
you
I'm on
go.
The ground, do you want to keep kicking me?
No, that's okay. That's probably as controversial as it gets.
My first thought for this was a band that had a real moment, but they had a real moment for like all of like 1 year, 2 years maybe.
Yep.
Before everything else moved around them.
Okay.
That band is Guns N' Roses. Their first album was Appetite for Destruction, came out in 1987.
Yep.
It's so singles, the singles on that album.
Hit me with them.
Welcome to the Jungle.
Welcome to the Jungle.
Yep. Yes.
You're welcome for that, everyone.
Sorry. Paradise City.
Yep. Where the girls are fat and they got big titties.
Exactly.
Yep.
Sweet Child of Mine.
Yep.
Also, a couple others in there. My Michelle, Think About You, Mr. Brownstone.
Yeah, they didn't top that, did they?
They didn't top that. And I'm going to go out on a limb here. I think they didn't top that because by the time that they released their second album, which was by the time they released their second genuinely worthwhile album was like early 90s. Wikipedia is trying to tell me that Lies is their second album and Patience is on there. It's not really. Use Your Illusion Part 1 and 2 are the ones that I'm sort of referring to. They came out the same day as everyone else in the world went, now we're actually all here for grunge and alternative rock. And like hair metal just died overnight. So it's not to say like that they weren't any good. It's just that like the rest of the world was like, cool, we're done with that now. See you later.
Mm.
So yeah, hard to top it when you just like everyone just moves on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's fair.
Yeah.
I've got All Killer No Filler, Sum 41. Ooh.
Nice.
Well, technically, I thought it was their second album, but we did some digging and their first release was technically an 11-song EP. So riddle me that, Batman.
Yeah.
But Fat Lip, In Too Deep, the other songs, I just don't really think they really topped it.
Heart Attack, underrated track of that song. Track of that album, sorry. Heart Attack. What else was on that album off the top of my head? Oh, no, this isn't good.
Does This Look Infected goes close.
That's not bad.
They've got Over My Head, The Hell Song, Still Waiting, All Still Messed waiting. Up. Yeah. And then arguably like...
What was the 2004 album when they tried
Chuck.
When they tried to do a Blink-182 and made it like real introspective? And
Chuck, because it's got Pieces, Welcome to Hell, We're
Pieces.
All to Blame.
Oh.
But arguably, Sum 41's best song, and in my opinion... Like, by far and wide, their most memorable, most nostalgic moment of my 7 to 8 year old life.
Yep.
Is their song Newts.
Newts.
Newts. Please. Did you ever watch Fantastic Four, the original?
The one with Chris Evans and
Jessica Alba.
Yep.
So I'm going to play you this song, and it should take you straight there.
Yep.
It does, doesn't it?
It's
flame on.
It
does it. He's sitting there going, "What the fuck?"
No, I just haven't watched that movie in probably 15 years.
No, it didn't do it for me either.
It wasn't a really central part of your childhood, was it?
That wasn't going to be a big part of the show.
No,
but I was, you know, hopeful you'd have a big reaction out of it. That's fine. I didn't want to do that anyway.
We can come back to that.
At the end of the day, All Killer, No Filler, Sum 41, haven't topped it. So, you know.
Yep. No, fair enough.
Shout out Sum 41. They're finishing their careers at good things.
I just want to do a very quick
pivot.
Tangent side note here. There was after the Oasis announcement.
Yes.
There was a lot of chat that Linkin Park would come back with Derek Whibley as their lead singer.
Yeah.
Turns out he's just writing a book. But which, like, I'm sure it's great. Don't be wrong.
Way to ruin the legacy of a band, hey? Yeah. I've become so numb.
I can see that. What? I'm dying.
Yeah, it wouldn't work, would it?
No.
I'm
going to take us, we've done a lot of rock and roll here. I'm going to take us out of the rock and roll world.
Yeah, you take us out of the rock and roll world.
The first album by Adam Wiles, who you might know better as Calvin Harris, was I Created Disco, came out in 2007.
Yep.
Unbeatable. Not to say that Calvin Harris hasn't had bangers since.
Yep.
But that first album is so good. And I think now that like artists like The Dare, like having that blow up and like that kind of indie sleaze rock and roll, dance music is back.
Yeah.
Go back and listen to it. That album is so good.
Would you argue that it's his best because he's just released singles since?
I mean, no, he's released albums since.
Okay.
But I feel like that's the one where there's like an idea for that album.
Yeah.
There's like a collective vision for that album. And he went and he executed like ideation to execution on project.
Yeah.
The others, they're fine.
He didn't fail to plan.
No, he planned to fail.
Yep. Shout out Adam, also known as Calvin.
Yes. Apparently.
Klein.
Doesn't like being called Calvin if he's not playing. Like even in interviews and stuff, he prefers to be Adam.
Yeah, that's strange because usually they like to protect their identity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Oh,
thanks, Mr. Harris.
No worries.
Yeah.
Other voices, other rooms, getaway plan. Pretty obvious.
Mm.
They released a couple of other albums, but that album for a debut, cooking with gas there.
Turn the stove on.
Shadows, Where the City Meets the Sea, Sleep Spindles, Red Flag, Rhapsody on a Windy Night.
I agree with you that that's the best album.
You're going to put in The Reckoning, aren't you?
No.
Yes.
What I want to say is,
you have a soft spot for The Reckoning. The Reckoning is not as good.
As a song, so good.
Yeah, but it's not Where the City Meets the Sea.
No, like Requiem, the album, I'm happy to leave it.
Yeah.
But as I would say, individually, the best getaway plan song is The Reckoning.
They did a really weird thing where they released an album before Other Voices, Other Rooms, technically, but it wasn't really an official release. And it was just a collection of like all their songs to that point.
Right.
Or maybe they did it after. I don't know, but it was really weird.
Okay.
It was just like an album of B-sides.
Okay.
And then, I don't know.
Maybe it was before they signed a label or something like
maybe.
That.
Maybe. It was one of the like strangest music careers because they were the shit for a while.
But yeah, they were red hot and then just...
And they just went nowhere. I reckon they must have signed a shit deal.
Might have copped a shit deal. There was a lot of those going around Australia at the time.
2007 that was. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Mm. Oh, well. But that was an obvious one. I'm just conscious I'll have four and you've got three.
That's fine.
Well, you go and then I'll go.
Right, great. Love it.
We'll just go. We'll riff.
We'll bounce. You know?
We'll bounce.
Calvin
we'll
Harris tiff. Bounce. Give Up by the Postal Service.
Timbaland Bounce.
Could not be beaten purely because Timbaland.
Got him.
Could not be beaten because the Postal Service have not dropped a second album.
Oh, so it's, yeah, their best by
it
default.
Their best by default, but also it's such a good album. And like, I'm not a Death Cab for Cutie fan. I'm happy to leave that out of the conversation. But
you're either Postal a Death Cab for Cutie fan.
Yep.
Or you don't like Death Cab for Cutie.
And I'm the latter.
Yeah.
Climb me because I'm the ladder, Sam. Mm. I know that's with T's. It's a
play on words.
It's a word
it's
joke.
A double a
vocabulary
entendre.
Joke. But like, yeah, I'll get around some Postal Service, not getting around Death Cab for Cutie. I don't want them to release a second album. I'm happy with this. It's exactly what I want. It's perfect. Don't touch it.
Don't ruin it.
It's not broken. Don't try to fix it.
I've told you. Don't exaggerate. I've told you once. I've told you twice. I've told you a million fucking times, Max. Anyway, I'm going to go with one.
Oh, you've got another one. No, okay.
Yes, I do. Killing With a Smile, Parkway Drive.
Mm.
This is a controversial one because arguably many fans will say that Horizons, their second album, is their best.
That's where I would have landed.
That's what Carrion, Idols and Anchors,
yes.
Horizons, the song.
It's basically that album launched DXC's career.
It did. It really did. DXC and a load of other acoustic artists that
yes
didn't make it as far as DXC did. Fun fact, I used to have a signed D and
D@CCD.
D&CD.
D@CCD. D@CCD.
Yeah, well, that's that's just a,
that's obnoxious.
That's a rural juror, red leather, yellow leather type situation.
New York. Unique New York.
Exactly.
Irish wristwatch.
D@CCD.
Yeah. She sells seashells by the seashore. But it's super controversial, but I was listening back to it the other day, and for an album that came out in 2005, it is genuinely unskippable and still super enjoyable. The breakdowns are huge. Like, I just, you can't argue the impact an album like that had and still has on the heavy scene.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's unbelievably good. And I agree that Horizons is good or just as good, but I'm going to say that is since Killing With A Smile, they've never surpassed the heights.
Are you going to say, so hang on, are you saying not necessarily that the music is the best on Killing With A Smile, but contextually within the scene it had the biggest impact? Is that what you're saying?
I think you could argue that the Horizon songs are better.
Right.
There's not as many movie breakdowns in there. There's a Jack Sparrow breakdown in Mutiny in Killing With A Smile. But the impact it had and the timelessness of it, for a 2005 album to even still be listening to it, like the production alone would be a turnoff for most people, but it's that good.
Mm.
I just think they've never surpassed it is probably where I'm going.
Would you say they've never topped their debut album?
Yes. I'm going to have to because it's my own argument. And everyone in the comments is going, you're a fucking idiot.
Quite a lot of flame, Sam.
Let us know in the comments.
Who's topped you in the comments? Let us know who's topped you.
And if you're new to the show, who's bottomed you?
Yeah, precisely. Maybe you're a...
It's 2024.
Maybe you're verse. That's fine.
Like, who is your bear?
Yeah. Anyway.
Anyway, on that note, follow us at 78amped everywhere. We're terrible with you.
See a couple of twinks.
Yeah, see you, twinks. We're terrible with outros. Follow us, subscribe to the pod. Love you all. Say hi to your mum.